Tucked away in a corner of the inside passage, off the western coast of British Columbia, lies an island too small to appear on the maps. Hansen Island, where killer whales make their rendezvous. Here, cetologist Dr. Paul Spong and his family make their home, the only human inhabitants. But whales are not the only ones who meet here. 11 years ago, Hansen Island witnessed the reunion of a father and son who met after 7 years of estrangement. The father, Dr. Freeman Dyson, is one of the most brilliant theoretical physicists of this century and was a principal architect of the Orion Project. Supported by the United States government in the 1950s, the Orion Project sought to construct a practical spaceship using atom bombs for propulsion. The son is George Dyson, now 33 years old. Rebelling against the ways of his father, George left home and made a life for himself in the wilds of Canada when he was 16. There, he began his studies of Eskimo and Aleut kayak design, a craft that was on the verge of extinction. The father chose a spaceship, the son, a canoe. The father dreamed of space colonies, the son of a free life in the unspoiled wilderness of this planet. Their story was told by Kenneth Brower in a non-fiction epic entitled The Starship and the Canoe, which forms the basis of this documentary. Freeman Dyson, now 63 years old, leads a quiet, scholarly life at the Institute for Advanced Studies in Princeton, where noted researchers from all over the world congregate to exchange ideas. Freeman came to the United States from England in 1948 and began his career in astrophysics in the company of Einstein and Oppenheimer. At 25, Freeman established a permanent place for himself in scientific history by mathematically unifying Einstein's theory of special relativity and quantum mechanics. But what Freeman really wanted to do was something quite different. He wanted to explore the universe by physically going out into space. In 1958, at the age of 35, Freeman set about building a spacecraft that would take him there.
I think this is in fact just a piece of the canister which held the explosive. And then I picked up these little pieces of metal from the ground just in order to have something to show that it wasn't all just a dream. The ship was driven by atomic bombs. That meant that you could go very far and very fast. Roughly we would be, say, 25 kilometers per second, or maybe a little bit more. So it could have easily carried 30 people. Yes, we planned to go to Mars first, and then Saturn afterwards. Yes, we said Saturn by 1970. Now, as far as I remember, what we thought of was something like 3 months to get to Mars, and 2 years to stay there and explore, and three months to come back, something like that.
In the Canoe in 1978, taking as his theme the contrasting lifestyles and philosophies of the two Dysons. Seven years after the book was published, in August 1985, we visited Ken and George at Ken's home in Belcarra Park, Vancouver. We had asked them to recreate a kayak journey they had made together in 1974, a journey that covered 620 miles of northwestern coastline, from Torch Bay in Alaska down to Hansen Island in British Columbia. That trip provided Ken with some of his most important materials for his book. After leaving his home in Princeton, George spent 3 years working on the ships and barges that ply the waters of the Inside Passage. Here he began his education on the ways of the sea, the forest, and the whales. At 19, he settled in Belcarra Park, building his home in the branches of a giant Douglas fir and setting his hand to the task of reconstructing the kayaks of the Aleuts. When he completed a canoe, George took it out and tested it on the waters of the Inside Passage and gradually refined his design skills through practical experience. To date, George has made 7 different kinds of kayaks. Shortly after the Starship in the Canoe was published, George descended from his treehouse. One reason for the move was his engagement to Ann Nyo, a professional photographer who met George while on assignment for the Seattle Times. During the summer of this filming, George perfected a 2-man kayak that combines all the best features of its many predecessors. This was the kayak chosen for the recreated journey.
Hey, George. What is this? Do you remember ever going through this? I don't remember that little thing.
Yes, it's real fun. No, but it's dry. Actually, you can't get through.
Oh, that's right.
It's dry.
August 6th, 1980.